You know what I wish? I wish that everyone could just be in my shoes for just a few moments, because I'm on fire. I'm having such great experiences, and it would be amazing just to feel the hope that I have now, really. And so I'm being on fire. I'm just going to express that, even whether someone listens or not. I will keep expressing it, and eventually, you know, some will gravitate to that and say, "Hey, I want to be on fire too." You know, how, what? Well, we have a lot to say in this video, actually. And realize we're not talking specifically to the intellect. We're not excluding it either. Okay, we're not excluding, we're honoring it too. But there's a deeper level to all this. And I had a dream last night that brought this to light. Somehow we were walking down a hillside from a church service, and we got down to a street. And on the right side of the street, there were these, it seemed to be ruffians who were roughing up people, or at least they looked like bullies or ruffians, let's say. And I wanted to go down that way, and I had a friend with me. And now, this friend shows up in dreams throughout my whole life. He represents the intellect. He's very intellectual. So it was the intellectual side of me. See, on the left, he was on the left, the intellectual side of me. And he said, no, you can't go down that way. Look at those guys, they'll beat you up. And I said, huh? I said, no, I don't think they'll beat me up. Why would they want to beat me up? You know, they're just some tough-looking guys. They look like they're, you know, might shove you around, you know. And I said, why would they bother me? That could be. And the intellect said, no, are you kidding? I'm not going down there. It's dangerous. And so he said they walked down a side street. And I was walking with him, and I said, where are we going? And I kind of feel like this neighborhood's not familiar. I don't feel like this is going home. Well, you know, I don't feel right about this. And in my mind, I said, you know what? I don't see why I'm not going where I want to go. You know, why should I be let him determine where I'm going? And then I woke up. That was the end of the dream. And I started really thinking about this dream. And it developed and developed and developed. And wow. I decided, you know what, I am going to walk past those ruffians. Not only that, I hope they do shove me around. Come on, bring it on. Yeah, I'm not afraid of them. And what happened was I started practicing this practice of zeroing out, flattening concepts that I'm introducing now. And I really started practicing it great. And I found out that this practice really is these ruffians. And they were shoving me around wonderfully. And it was absolutely fantastic. And it was so great that there were tears streaming down my eyes. It was the greatest experience of my life. It was like running the gauntlet. It's like going through a gauntlet and someone, you know, shoves you like, you're like, I am free. I'm both free and I'm not free. So one shoves you and says, I'm free. And the other one then shoves you back, says, I am not free, and I am free, and I am not free. So I'm getting shoved back and forth. These ruffians are shoving me back and forth. But they're the most wonderful, they're divine ruffians, actually. And this is what I found out. these are the ruffians that Jesus has sent. And I absolutely loved it. And I absolutely understood it, and I got it. You know, I got it. And I said, hey, please keep shoving me around forever, you know, as long as you want. Don't stop. Keep shoving me. This is wonderful. Because what was happening was I was doing this practice in the right way, in a tremendously effective way. And that's what's required. I'm both this and not this, both this and not this. Refusing to let me take a definition. You see, every time I do a definition, one of these ruffians would shove me over to the other one, and then they'd say, no, that's not the definition, this is it, and they'd shove me to the other one, and then they'd shove me back like that. And so I was just like being shoved back and forth, back and forth, just watching this and experiencing it. It was absolutely wonderful, and that's why I'm on fire. Okay, so this is already a big wow. You can feel, wow, that's, okay, this is intense. Of course it is, yes it is, it's wonderful. And I found out that only by experiencing practice do you really know what it's about. You can never get it intellectually at all. The intellect looks at it and says, oh, okay, I can see there's ruffians there, okay. But it never really gets what it's about. Only through experiencing, it's the only way. And how was it that I decided to experience it? Well, this is simply through all the little steps like that. I finally said to the intellect, no, intellect, this is something that I want. Okay. And holy cow. Best experience of my life. So really, right practice will be the best experience you've ever had in your life. If it's not, then you're not really practicing. You're intellectualizing the practice. I was actually really practicing. I really was. And I was seeing how the wisdom of it. I was experiencing the wisdom of it. Wow, I'm both abiding and not abiding. I'm both abiding in truth and not abiding in truth. I'm both I have both arrived in truth and not arrived in truth. What this does, it completely zeroes out the intellect, which is basically the effort spirit trying to define what spirit is. That's the intellect. It's trying to define, which is really would be death. It's trying to kill. Spirit's trying to die to what it is. So the intellect will say, well, you've arrived at truth. That's a definition. So I say, I have arrived at truth, and no, I have not arrived at truth. Yes, I have both arrived at truth and not arrived at truth. In other words, you simply refuse any definition at all. However, we're living in this world as an appearance. We're appearing in this dream, and this dream demands expression. Okay, we could just sit mute like this, like Ramana Maharshi. Yes, we could. Our culture doesn't really allow for that very much, and so let us be practical and say our culture, the world, demands expression of us. But how do you express what cannot be defined? How do you express? You cannot. So the best way to do it is by this double, it's a double negative, either way you look at it. I am both this and not this. I am both abiding in non-duality, and I am not dwelling in non-duality. You see, because the persona, spirit pretending to be dead, lives, thinks it lives, it is a demand for definition. It is a demand for definition. This is why we have words. This is why we have concepts. This is why we have expressing words, concepts, ideas, and all this. So, to express it, it's this double way. It's to say, yes, I am both. I have both arrived, and I have not arrived. Yes, I have definitely arrived, and I have definitely not arrived. This is a way to put it. Yes, I am definitely in bliss, and I am definitely not in bliss. Okay, what does this do? Zeroes out the definition, zeroes out the concepts, flatten the concepts, flattens the definition. And so, the demand for expression is there. We're still using words, we're using concepts, etc. Okay. So the intellect says, well, at least you're acknowledging that I, quote-unquote, exist as a creative expression. Yes. Now, Ram Maharshi was just, quiet, still. He said, by saying nothing, he's saying everything. Right? By not expressing any definition at all, he is, so to speak, saying all definitions, which is, endless, so that doesn't really have a definition. But that was quite a rare case, and we should not hold ourselves immediately to such a standard at all, because we need to practice this. So I did this extended practice as I'm lying in bed. And I could feel the liberation, I could feel the liberation happening. Yes, I am both beyond definition and not beyond definition. You see, to say that I am beyond definition is a definition in terms of everything that we're pragmatically used to, okay? So we cannot just be completely non-pragmatic. It doesn't work. It's a fool's errand, that one, okay? So at least we are, seem to be defining, okay? That we believe that life is definition. We believe that definition is life. And to just come on to people in complete silence, for most, that they would feel that you're trying to attack them in some way, really. And so we do still use the form that definition is used to, the format, okay, words and sentences, expressions, format. And yet, it's a zeroed out, the content is zeroed out. There's no definitional content, but the form is still there. Okay. So this is the practice, and you cannot get it until you do it. This is very true. So even though I'm expressing this, which is, you know, there's a practical requirement here in this world, I am also saying you cannot get it until you do it. And when you do it, you will get it. Now, how long has it taken me to have this really deep experience, great experience of my life? I've been doing this how long? Maybe 3-4 days, let's say a week or less, actually. So you start out simply and you get your feet wet. It's very much like that, getting into a swimming pool. You get your feet wet, you kind of step into the pool a little bit where the steps are. You get a little deeper and you get kind of used to water. And at some point, then you kind of just sink into the water and say, oh, it's okay now. That's like that. So it takes a little while, but the little steps are what's important. The little steps are what is important to actually, even though it seems completely feeble at first, as it did with me, so it's very feeble. But holy cow, once I got used to it, I was able to apply it in greater and greater and greater ways and embrace it and say, yeah, I have arrived in truth and I have not arrived in truth. I have arrived in bliss and I have not arrived in bliss. And there's a feeling of like authenticity that it's faint. It maybe is faint, but you know, you're aware that there is something there. This is very pregnant, so to speak. You can feel it. It's a wow, like wow. This is what I really want. This is really working. I know this is really a very effective practice. There's no question about it. And yet, only through experiencing it, being shoved around by these ruffians, I said, "Oh my gosh, what wonderful ruffians!" This is, and so I'm craving the, you know, this ruffian being shoved around. Oh, please shove me around, perfect, you know, do your thing, ruffians. So the intellect may be just sitting there looking like, what the heck's going on? I don't quite say, is there something, you know? Yes, this is wonderful, and yes, this is not wonderful. Yes, is what's important is to have this yes, 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 yes attitude towards it. Like, yes, I have arrived, and yes, I have not arrived. So this gives a positive definitional spin to it, you see, and it calms us down. We have to emphasize that we think definition is our life. Spirit believes that definition is life. But it's really attempt to die. It's really spirit's attempt to die. Now, shifting gears just a little bit to let this sink in, like, oh, wow, because this is very intense. Into the political, social, political world, which most people dwell in that world, okay? I don't really dwell in that world. But the Holy Spirit says, just, you know, be aware of what's going on a little bit. There's a dynamic going on that's very, very interesting and refreshing, actually. As I came out of this spiritual practice, I recognized it. I said, wow. Wow, 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 wow. There's two ways of looking at it. We're going to highlight the Donald Trump because he's in the crosshairs. He is on the stage right now. He is on the world stage right now. Why is he on the world stage? Now, there's two ways of looking at him. There's two ways of looking at it. And then what I was able to see is, wow. I was able to see it in a glass half full way. Like, here is a wonderful ruffian, actually. A wonderful ruffian. And he's pushing around the political correctness. He's pushing it. He has no fears. He's shoving it. He's like a rascal, a ruffian. But he's, if you look at it a certain way, it's a wonderful ruffian, because he's basically saying, hey, you can't kill me. I can't die. What he's really saying is, look, I've tried to kill myself with all these beauty pageants and women and luxury and stuff, but I can't kill myself.
Yeah.
I don't know what it is. I just can't kill myself. I don't know what I am. I'm just very talented. I'm just very wonderful. No matter what I do to be an idiot, I'm not really an idiot, you know? And the political correct people who want to, basically, what we have is the mortician in chief in the White House. He's like a pallbearer, a mortician, really. He's like a mortician, and he's like giving a eulogy, and we're having this funeral for spirit. That funeral has died, and we're holding this funeral for spirit. And he speaks in very funereal tones, you know, and all the political correct people are there, say, oh, yeah, it's very important. We are here, brothers and sisters, to solemnize and the death of spirit, the death of authenticity, and so it's like we're attending a funeral. It's like the last 8 years have been, or 6 years, whatever, we've been attending like a funeral. and Trump comes in and says, what funeral? I'm not dead. Whatever he said, we're having a funeral here. And he says, well, you know, I don't know what it is, but I just have to speak up. I cannot, I can't always be quiet, and even in a funeral, you know. It's like that. It's like somebody coming into a funeral, and everybody's sobbing and crying. And it's like, oh my God, spirit's dead. This is just awful. You know, I'm commiserating one another, you know, just looking, patting each other's back. It's just so terrible that spirit has finally died. My gosh, we just got to take some time to get used to this. It's going to take a while to get used to this, you know. Trump comes striding it down there. Hey, everybody, you know. Well, you know, hey, you know, I'm not dead. What's going on here? I feel great. I'm wonderful. I'm very smart, actually. Yeah, we don't need to have this funeral. Come on. What is this? People are like aghast, you know. It's like, what? What the heck is this? Who let this idiot in? You know, where's security? Security, security, security. You know, we're having a funeral here, man. We're solemnizing the death of spirit. This is terrible. And they're saying, shushing, shh, shush, shush. And they finally, you know, they get the cheap shushers. You know, we got these wonderful PC shushers. We could use some other terms for them, but we can call the shushers, the usher shushers. Call the usher shushers. And they come bustling over. Shh, shh, Donald, shh, 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 quiet, quiet, quiet. You can't say that. You know, it's like mother coming over. Here comes mother, you know, bustling over. Donald, you got to be quiet. This is a funeral. You don't understand. And says, what do you mean? What does there understand? I'm not dead. There's no funeral. What's going on here? This is a fake funeral, you know. We don't need a funeral. We haven't died. Come on. Maybe we've been sick. We haven't died. And the mother says, Donald, don't do that. You're very naughty. Very naughty boy. I'm going to have to spank you. Come on. We have to. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on to the back of the church here or whatever. And that's where they take, like, in church, the babies start crying and, you know, acting up. The mother has to pick them up and come, you know, go outside and out the back. And they're still crying. They got to go outside. So, Donald, you need to go outside. Go, go. He says, no, I don't feel like going outside. You know, I like being here. I like being here. I think I need to talk with all you guys, you know. And so, you know, with all his faults and all his quirks and all of this, you know, he is this wonderful ruffian, you know, that's shoving the political correctness, you know. And we're like, wow, you know, we're not dead. You know, maybe we're not dead. So he's bringing this thought, like, hey, maybe we're not dead. Maybe this is a sham funeral. Maybe this is a funeral trying to convince ourselves that spirit has died. Aha, You see, now he doesn't quite have the nuances like this that I have here in expressing it, because I have an even more wonderful ruffian friend, which is called Jesus Christ. I do have a personal relationship with Jesus. I have a now relationship with Jesus. I have a ruffian relationship with Jesus. He's this wonderful ruffian that shoves you. Hey, not this definition. This, not this either. Or not this one. Not this one. And not this one. You know, yes, I am happy. No, I am not happy. Yes, I am happy. No, I am not happy. Yes, I am happy. No, I am not happy. Or yes, I am happy. Yes, I am not happy. Yes, I am happy. Yes, I am not happy. Uh-huh. You know, okay, the form of definition is there. I don't quite see the content. The content is now. So Jesus is shoving us into the now. So I have a now relationship with Jesus Christ. He's absolutely wonderful. He trumps even Trump, you know. He even trumps Trump. But Trump is this wonderful actor. He is a great actor. Truly, what a great, thank God for Donald Trump. Thank God for this wonderful actor with all these warts and blemishes and everything. He says, hey, I don't have time. I don't have time to be totally politically correct. He's in this funeral, you know. He's in this funeral, and the mortician in chief is, you know, and the professional sob mourners are there too, you know. Yeah, we're dead. You know, now we're going to have to adjust to life without spirit. It's awful, but we'll find a way. Yeah, it's terrible. And he comes in and says, I'm here, you know. I feel great. You know, we're going to have a wonderful time. What are you all crying? What are you all for? Sad? There's nothing to be sad for, you know. And it's just like, there's complete shock. They're in complete shock. All the spin doctors, doctresses, you know, the professional mourners and the professional mother shushers. Donald, be quiet. You can't say that. That's not allowed here in this funeral. So this is to be celebrated. Trump is to be celebrated, actually. You know, the PC crowd absolutely hates him because they want to have this dignified funeral, and he's disrupting the funeral. You know, he is disrupting the funeral, and this is absolutely great farce. This is divine farce that is taking place. And you say, well, how could Trump be, you know? Well, he is. He is a player. He is a player. You know, and his faults and peccadillos and quirks, whatever you want to call them, that only makes it all more interesting, like the farce. Often some of the protagonists have this quirkiness to them, which makes it seem like they're very human too, you know, and yet somehow they're not dead, you know. We can feel that, like, somehow Trump's not dead, you know, and how is that possible? And he's bragging, like, hey, you know what, I've tried to kill myself, but I couldn't, so I'm not dead. I'm still not dead. Everybody's trying to kill me, but I'm still not dead. And you know what, I don't think I can die, you know. I think I am. I'm irrepressible. You know, I don't know what it is, but I'm just completely irrepressible. You know, it's just me. You know, what can I say? And so, this is like, you know, a teachable moment for everybody at that level. Now, there's a deeper teachable moment with Jesus Christ, the great teacher, who is absolutely, who's even more wonderful, who's able to push us even to the depths. Even when we're saying, oh my gosh, I'm enlightened. And yes, I'm enlightened. And yes, I'm not enlightened. Yes, I'm enlightened. Yes, I'm not enlightened. Yes, I'm enlightened. Yes, I'm not enlightened. See, Jesus has no trouble whatsoever in pushing us in every which way. Like, right? So there's only the now-ness, so to speak. And yes, I'm in the now, and yes, I'm not in the now. Yeah, yes, I'm both in the now and, yes, not in the now. See? Form of definition, no content in the definition. So the now is both now and not now. The now is both now and not now. Now, this is a little more intellectual statement, but it's better, the deeper practice, say, yes, I am in the now, and yes, I am not in the now. Yes, I am both in the now, and yes, I'm not. I'm both in the now, and yes, I am not in the now. So, I love Trump. I love Trump. I love what he's doing. I love what he's doing. Understanding it's a grand spectacle, and it's on a certain level, fine. But I also love what I'm doing, and I also love what Jesus is doing. And this is, you know, I have a lot of that in me, like what Trump is doing. I have a lot of that in me, but it's being expressed at a deeper level. And it's very liberating. It's very liberating. But it's doing it the right way. That's why it's liberating. Because we're not criticizing the intellect. We're not attacking the intellect, not criticizing the intellect. And Trump he doesn't either, really. He says what needs to be said and then moves on. He says, what's the big deal, you know? Why are you getting hung up on this trivia? Idiocy. Peck at the little trivial things, you know, just... what's the big... why are you getting stuck there? What is this? You know, you bashed me, I bashed you back a little bit, and then we'll move on. You know, what is this political correctness? You know, they're all like sobbing. No, you interrupted the funeral. This is hideous. This is horrible. How are we ever going to get the atmosphere back of this funeral, of this memorial service? My God, I don't know how we're going to be able to, you know, and they become obsessed with this trivial little stuff. It's, you know, and it's just, and he says that, you know, okay. They want to act like idiots. Okay, fine. You know, next. Next. And, you know, I'm not dead. I'm not attending some funeral service. What is this? And so, love it. Love it, love it, love it. Thank God for it. Because people are feeling like, wow, maybe I'm not dead too. I'm feeling some authenticity here. Like, I've tried to kill myself, but for some reason, I'm not quite dead, you know. I tried to define what I am, but I just can't seem to do it, you know. And no matter how anyone tries to define me, that's not it either. You know, I just can't seem to define what I am, but well, you know, what can I, nothing I can do about that. So it is a wonderful time right now where we have various players speaking up. Now I'm on a very tiny stage here, but the stage has depth to it. You see, it's tiny in a certain way, but in another way, it's got massive depth to it. And I imagine like what I could have done at the debate, and I was able to imagine a much, much greater way to flip the script on everybody, actually. But Trump didn't do that. He did it in a minimal way, okay, which is fine, because most people, it was too much for them anyway. But I'm able to imagine, you know, just a massively greater way to flip the script in such a situation. But he's doing his thing at a level where most people, they can only handle a little bit, okay, of authenticity. I'm doing it for those who can handle a lot more authenticity. We're flipping the script entirely here, entirely. Now, what's my reaction to Trump? I get a laugh out of it. I get a laugh out of it. A chuckle. You know, this is when you meet authenticity, you feel like, hey, this is humor. Whatever's happening is humorous. I had an uncle like that. It was very authentic. Most authentic person I've ever met in the world. And you couldn't help but laugh when you're around him. Even though he did not, hadn't said anything funny or whatever, you knew he was going to. You knew he was going to. So I said, why should I wait until he does something funny? I'm just going to start laughing right now. Because I know I'm going to be laughing sooner or later, so why not? Might as well start laughing right now. And that's how it was, actually, with him. He just meet him, and he just start laughing. He just start laughing. He said, this is going to be great. So I might as well start celebrating this right now. I'm happy right now. I'm in a great mood right now because I know he is going, there's no question about it, he's going to be just, because he was just outrageously authentic, you know, just... And somehow he was able to do it, you know. The world left him alone, you know. And he had this brilliant authenticity to it. And if he got it, just, oh my gosh. And so you could be in public and you could be just falling down laughing, you know. And he would just be playing the straight man like, you know, I'm just being me. I'm not, you know, trying to do anything funny or anything. I'm just being me. But he'd allow others to be falling down laughing. You know, in public, you'd be eating food and you'd just be like, people must have thought I was on drugs or something. You know, he's just like absolutely hilarious. Unapologetic, you know, he was unapologetic straightforward, unapologetic, but sincere and nice and stuff. Now my take on Trump in listening to him, I say, is he's not a bad, he's sincere. He's not a bad guy. He's not a bad guy, actually. And this is what people who've been with him, known him his whole life, say. You know, no, he's got this bombast, he's got this persona, okay. But underneath, he's not some, you know, vicious, backstabbing, duplicious, double-faced, horrible, blah, 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 blah. No, no. He is what he is. And he's not apologetic about it at all. We keep thinking we need to apologize. When you come across someone who's not apologetic, it's like, wow, what? He says, yeah, I know. I'm egotistical. So, yeah, this is what I am. You know, I'm not apologizing for it. It just is what it is. And I know this is like, but you know what? It's not killing my spirit. But you know, I can't die. My spirit can't really die. And well, they're going after him. You know, they're trying to cut off his head. You know, really, ISIS is more in the United States than it is in the Middle East. It's the political correct people in this world is a worse version of ISIS, actually, if you really want to be honest about it. Because they're trying not just to cut off your head, they're trying to cut off your spirit. You know, ISIS, they're butchers, you know, right? Terrible butchers, they cut off your head. You know, but the political correct people, the funeral attendees, you know, they're trying to cut off your spirit. They're trying to cut off the head of your spirit. They're trying to cut you off from spirit. So this is worse, way, way worse. Jesus said, don't fear those who kill the body. Fear those who kill the spirit or trying to kill the spirit, you know. Yeah, this is true. We have a worse situation in the United States than they do in the Middle East, much worse. And, you know, we have this mortician in chief and all his little pallbearers, you know, and all these professional mourners. And they're saying, hey, America, you know, we got to mourn. We're in mourning here. Spirit has died. We have to accept this fact. We got to teach this fact. Everybody's got to come to acceptance. You can't be in denial. We're trying to help you out. You're in denial about it. You know, you're not going along. You're in denial. You're in irrational denial. Oh, don't worry. We'll help you out. You know, here comes Trump, says, hey, everybody, you know, I'm not dead. And people say, hey, I'm not really dead either, but the pallbearer in chief is, you know, telling me I'm dead, and I've got to mourn the death of spirit. I don't feel spirits dead, actually. I know it's lurking somewhere. And so we're starting to, like, say, hey, wait a minute, what is this? Do we really have to be quiet in this fake funeral service? This is all a sham. Are you really supposed to? I mean, is that bad form? Who's having the bad form? Isn't it the arrogant ones who are claiming that spirit is dead? What they're really trying to do is hold the service and think that that will kill spirit. But if we all pretend that spirit is dead, it will be dead. Aren't those the ones that are simply over-the-top arrogant? And why should we cater to that? This is just sheer arrogance. So sheer arrogance lacks creativity in its sheerness. Okay, so we cannot go along with that. Because we're not honoring our creativity, really, by sheer arrogance. Okay, it's not really honoring our creativity. So we gotta bust up this funeral thing, you know? We gotta bust it up. And Trump's doing his thing. Let each one of us do our thing, you know? It's just that's who he is. And again, they're going after him with every weapon, with howitzers and anti-ballistic missiles and every possible armament in their PC, vast armament of, you know, PC, of PC-ness. They're shooting everything at him. They'll probably start using electromagnetic pulses against him. Everything possible to say, you stop disrupting our memorial service. This is very important. We need to memorialize the death of spirit. Only by doing that can we move on. Now, in hearing this, you're probably shocked. Your intellect is shocked, because your intellect likes to show good form, you know, good form. And the intellect says, well, you know, yeah, I don't really agree with it, but I don't want to show bad form here, so, you know, I don't want to bust it up at it. And it's just like, whoa. But you get used to it. You get used to it bit by bit by bit by bit. And as the shock wears off, you say, hey, yeah, I'm kind of familiar, getting familiar with this. Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, out by the, there's a grave with a tombstone on it, you know, there. And, and out by the grave, the tombstone, there's all these maidens, weeping maidens, putting flowers on the, you know, around the tombstone. They're hysteric, wailing and pulling their hair and saying, so terrible spirit has died. How dare you not honor their grief, you know? How is Trump to walk around not honoring their grief? You know, the lady is grieving. Donald, respect the lady's grief. He says, I don't have time to perfectly respect anybody's grief, you know, the lady's grief. Frankly, I don't have time to perfectly respect the lady's grief. And, you know, next. And people said, what do you mean next, Donald? You can't go in the next. This is too important. You dishonored the lady's grief. He said, well, yeah, everybody's hitting me with grief. I don't got time to honor everybody's grief perfectly. Come on. Come on, what is this? It's gone crazy here. This is beautiful. This is beautiful theater. I mean, if you don't appreciate this, you don't have a spirit. I mean, your spirit is, you're trying to kill spirit if you don't appreciate this. This is great theater. This is great farce. This is beautiful theater that's happening. What a persona. What a persona, you know. I mean, what a mask. What a mask is being worn by spirit here. But if you are in spirit and you're feeling it, you realize, wow, yeah, I can get free. Then you will see it as this beautiful drama, wonderful drama. And again, these grieving maidens is how it, the PC crowd, how they do it. You know, you're supposed to, you know, it's the honor of the lady's honor. You know, and he says, you know, what honor? You know, I don't have time to perfectly honor these ladies, or, you know, whatever they think they're doing, you know, because it's just sheer arrogance. I don't have time to honor sheer arrogance perfectly, to be quite frank. To be quite frank, I don't have the time to honor sheer arrogance perfectly. So, you know, you just have to live with that. And this, of course, blows the whole scenario, right? Because they're trying to have a perfect death, and all the grieving maidens with their flowers and... You know, it's part of that whole show, trying to get us to believe that spirit really is buried down in that ground and it's not coming back. You know, why else would they be grieving so grievously grieving? And so to blow their cover, you know, to you know, it's like the whole thing's just blown, the whole play. You know, what the heck? So, well, we got then to have another go at it. No, why? Why have another go at what's impossible? What is that but sheer arrogance? That's not creativity, actually. Now, once you do have a go at it, then you're going to be creative at it. But the idea is not a creative idea. You see, it's not a truly creative idea. And therefore, there's nothing there to really honor at all. There's nothing there to honor at all. We honor the form that it's taken, but there's no content to it. So there's no content to honor. You see? I don't have the time to perfectly honor no content, you know? I'm honoring the form, absolutely honoring the form. This is what we all need to do, and we will. We're still using words, we're still using concepts, apparently, but we're practicing accepting the zeroing out of this, the wonderful zeroing out, and recognizing there's never been any content to this dream. The dream of spiritual death has no content. It's a zero content. So all it can have is form, right? So our creativity has been very creative with the form of it, you know, which is fine, and we can honor that. Zero out, flatten it out doesn't mean the form is gone. You just say yes, I am abiding in the now, and yes, I am not abiding in the now. Yes, I am both abiding in the now, and yes, not abiding in the now. Indeed, yes, I am both abiding in the now and not abiding in the now. Yes, it's not the power of now. It's both the power of the now and not the power of the now. You see, this is very important. This is deeper. Okay, we're going deeper than the power of now. It is both the power. I am in the power of the now and not in the power of the now. It is both the power of the now and not the power of the now. Okay, this is what it really is. Okay. It's both the now and not the now. But put it in a personal way. Say, as like you're expressing it. Yes, I'm expressing the power of the now and not expressing the power of the now. Or yes, I'm feeling the power of the now and not feeling the power of the now. Or okay. Let it be. Let it keep flowing. Don't disrupt the flow. So don't get hung up on semantics. If you're feeling a little hung up, just keep going. That is fine. So this is what it is. There's no content. That's what we're saying. There is no content. How do you express no content? Well, there's both content and there isn't content. Okay? There both is content and isn't content. So what is that? It's form dancing without, there's no content there, but there's a dance of form. We honor that. So yes, there's both content and there's not content. I'm experiencing content and no content. I'm experiencing the now and no now. Yes, I'm experiencing the now and the not now. Okay? I'm experiencing the now and the not now. There you go. I'm experiencing the now and the not now. I'm experiencing the now and the not now. I'm experiencing the pure spaciousness and the not pure spaciousness. The non-pure space. I'm experiencing the spaciousness and the non-spaciousness. I'm experiencing the pure spaciousness and the non-pure spaciousness. So what am I really experiencing? Can't be defined, right? And yet, honoring our creativity, we're honoring the form. Okay, the form. There's no content to there's no definitional content to what I'm experiencing at all. But in order to express in any way, I'm both experiencing the pure spaciousness and the non-pure spaciousness. I'm both experiencing pure spaciousness and non-pure spaciousness. I'm both experiencing spaciousness and not spaciousness. However you want to put it. And you can play with it in your practicing. Play with it. It's a play. Practicing is really a play. You're playing with it. And if something doesn't feel quite right, you say, okay, well, I'll do it in a different way. Okay, and gradually you get familiar with like this. It's not some rigid intellectual exercise at all. It's a play. So as you see, I'm just kind of trying this. Yeah. And some of them like hit hard. It's like, wow, that really, I feel great. Yeah, I'm feeling great and not feeling great. I'm experiencing pure spaciousness and not experiencing pure spaciousness. I'm in the pure spaciousness and I'm not in the pure spaciousness. Okay, yes, I'm in pure spaciousness and I'm not in pure spaciousness. Yeah, that hits hard. That's wonderful. Now, see, the intellect doesn't get this, but it does get that it's being honored. Okay. And this is enough. Whereas spirit gets this. Spirit gets this. There's something within me I feel. I say, oh, I really get this. Yeah. I both get this and don't get this. Right. But beyond that, there is this, what we can say is a getting this. But in relating to the intellect, call it the heart, the intellect, person, persona, the self, the I, you know, it doesn't matter. It's just an attempt to define what we are, whether we define it by saying, well, I am the heart. Well, that's a definition. Just, I am both in the heart and not in the heart. I am both in the heart and not in the heart. Now, Ramana Maharshi would certainly appreciate this. He often said that he's in the heart, dwelling in the heart. But actually, in talking with those who actually did have some conversations with him about this, he said, no, I'm only saying that for those to please the form that they want to hear, you know. But really, it's neither this nor that. It's not definable at all. I think Punjaji actually asked him about that. He says, why are you saying? He says, I don't feel it's any location at all. He says, yeah, there is no location to it. But to honor, I have to say this, you know, it's okay. I need to say this to people who, you know, it's their intellect. They want to be honored. Their intellect wants to be honored. So I'm just honoring their intellect by saying that. But yeah, you're right. It's neither this nor that. It's both this and that, and neither this nor that. How can no definition be expressed? It cannot be expressed, right? I mean, but we can get honor our intellect by saying it. So saying, yes, I am both in the heart and not in the heart. This is the open door. This is, I'm both in pure spaciousness and not in pure spaciousness. To be able to say this with conviction and acceptance, you know, this is being pushed by the divine ruffians, isn't it? How fortunate to come across such a divine ruffian. Where do you find such a divine ruffian? You know, I found it within me, within the practice. I've never come across in the world such a divine ruffian. Maybe because I didn't want to, right? The intellect was afraid. I am both, yes, I'm both abiding in pure spaciousness and not abiding in pure spaciousness. Yes, I am both abiding in the heart and not abiding in the heart. Now, when I go silent, what's happening? The wow. Full stop in the wow here. It just... So at any moment in your practicing, feel absolutely free. You have my permission. If that helps, to just go absolutely silent. In the midst of a sentence, you might be just practicing and just suddenly say, oh my gosh, I can feel it. And just go silent. And there's no pressure to come out of that silence. Is the Donald outrageous? Yes. Am I more outrageous? Absolutely. Is Jesus even more outrageous than me? Absolutely. Is Ramana more outrageous? Absolutely. You see? It's great outrageousness, right? So fortunate to come across this. I feel so fortunate that Trump is doing what he's doing. The whole country should feel blessed and fortunate because it is a blessing. It really is a blessing. The funeral is being disrupted. The funeral service is being disrupted. I feel very fortunate too to be able to share this what I'm doing here. Very fortunate. It is a blessing. Absolutely is a blessing. I do have this, you know, so-called divine ruffianness in me too. It's the best part of waking up. It's like that Folgers commercial. The best part of waking up is Folgers in your cup. Well, the best part of waking up is this, is to come across this divine ruffianness. You know, like, I'm both abiding in the heart and not abiding in the heart. Oops, where's the funeral? I think that just disrupted the funeral, didn't it? Yes, I'm... Yeah, Trump should come on the funeral. We can say, yes, I'm disrupting the funeral and not disrupting the funeral. I'm both disrupting the funeral and not disrupting the funeral. Right? Feel that. My uncle had no PC-ness in him whatsoever. He just told it like it really was. He said, and the way he told it, he said, I'm sorry, you know. I said, well, you know, the way he expressed it was so beautiful and gracious, you know, you couldn't help but laugh. Some people are kind of little, you know, PC people might be a little, but you couldn't really attack him, you know, because he was so genuine and authentic about it. And he said, well, this is really... how it really is, you know it is, and I'm just letting you know in a nice way. These days the PC crowd would say he's like this, you know, they would just try to stick as many forks in as possible and say, you're done. You know, you're done. And like what Trump would say, no, you're finished. You're the ones who are finished. I mean, this funeral's finished, folks. But he'd say, well, this funeral is finished and not finished. Yes, I'm disrupting the funeral and I'm not disrupting the funeral. But, you know, in terms of, you know, like the reporters say, hey, you know, you're disrupting this funeral. He says, no, I already answered you. We're done. We're done. That's it. You know, moving on to the next thing. Come on. Don't get hung up on this. Yeah, I'm disrupting the funeral and I'm not disrupting the funeral. Now, how is that possible? Well, it's a fake funeral. It's sheer arrogance. So why should we be perfectly politically correct with sheer arrogance? You can't. There's no content to it. There's no content to honor. So you can't perfectly honor. It's not possible. All you can do is hold this funeral and weep, but it you know, it's never going to work. It's just delay. And so we honor the delay. Yeah. But it's spiritual spirit that's honoring the delay. Not delay honoring the delay. It's spirit that's honoring the delay. You know, Trump's not being dishonorable. He's not being dishonorable. You know, he's just telling it like it is. This is who I am. This is what I'm doing. You know, he's not being dishonorable to move on. You know, the maiden is grieving. Oh, her. You know, you know. How dare you interrupt her grieving? He says, well, you know, I just can't help it. I mean, this is what I am, and I'm, you know, if that disrupted her grieving, you know, that's what it is. It is what it is. I'm moving on. I can't be perfectly politically correct all the time, and that's it. Finished. We're finished here. And the maidens and all the people come. How? No. This is terrible. This is terrible. Stop. Everything. Everybody stop. I want everybody to stop. I said, everybody stop. I stamped my foot, too. I said, I stamped my foot. Everybody stop. This is terrible. We must have a teacher moment here. No, nobody can move on from this. There's something terrible happened here. You know, really terrible happened here. And we have to restore the honor of the grieving maidens. You know, the Vestal Virgins are mourning the death of spirit here. Nobody has the right to do that to the Vestal Virgins, you know. We've like reinstituted the whole Vestal Virgin thing. A PC Vestal Virgins are like everywhere, you know. They should have a sign like, yes, I'm a Vestal Virgin. But we have a sign, yes, I'm a Vestal Virgin, and I'm also not a Vestal Virgin. Yes, I'm both a Vestal Virgin and not a Vestal Virgin. You know? This is a wonderful technique for those of you who might think that people will try to push you into Vestal Virginness. You know, if, for instance, if you happen to be identifying with a female neutral body form, you can say, oh, yes, I am a Vestal Virgin, and yes, I'm both a Vestal Virgin and not a Vestal Virgin. Try that one. Yes, I'm both a Vestal Virgin and not a Vestal Virgin. And how does that feel? Wow. See, the Vestal Virgins were the untouchables in Rome. The untouchables. Above the emperor, above the head of all religion, etc., etc., the top, very top. There's only one rule. They had to be celibate. That's it. That's the only rule. Other than that, there were no rules. They were the rules. They made the rules, actually. So we have a lot of Vestal Virgins in the world right now, all over the world. And yet you do not have to play by their rules. So what you say is, yes, I am both the Vestal Virgin and not the Vestal Virgin. You see? So you're honoring this creativity of form of the Vestal Virginness, but you're also honoring your freedom from that form too. And you don't have to honor no content. You can't honor no content. It's not possible. So you zero it out. Yes, I am both the Vestal Virgin and not the Vestal Virgin. And just let that resonate. And people thought Jesus is just a social worker, right? Just a rabbi from the Sea of Galilee trying to help people deal with the onerous burden of taxes and trying to, you know, right. Yeah, I'm just this poor little rabbi, and I'm also not this poor little rabbi. Yes, I am Jesus, and I am not Jesus. Jesus could say that. Yes, I am Jesus, and I am not Jesus. Yes, I am this Galilean rabbi, and I am not this Galilean rabbi. So it's like the spiritual oxygen. I'm getting like spiritual oxygen, like we're on spiritual oxygen mask here. And that's what it's about. We're being revived, as it were. This funeral, like we're falling asleep. It's so boring. The funeral director in chief, the mortician, the funeral director in chief is just like boring us to tears. Yeah. That funereal tone, I just can't take it anymore. Oh, change the channel. My God. Goes on, drones on and on and on and on, not an ounce of authenticity to be found. Of course, how can we? We're born in the death of authenticity. How can we be authentic? It's not possible anymore, my God. So yes, I'm the funeral attendee, and I'm not the funeral attendee. Yes, I'm both the funeral attendee and not the funeral attendee. Yes, I'm both playing by the rules and not playing by the rules. Yes, I'm both playing by the rules and not playing by the rules. And I can tell you that this is something that I've looked forward to my entire life. Will I ever get back to this authenticity that I felt when I was young? Yes, we're getting the oxygen. We're being revived here. Dr. Jesus is reviving us. People say, do you love Jesus? I say, yes, I both love Jesus and don't love Jesus. Yes, I both love Jesus and don't love Jesus. Keep in mind that all words, all concepts presuppose inherently their opposite, an opposition to it. Okay, it's a definition. It's all a definition. So even say, yes, I love Jesus is a definition. Love cannot be defined, actually. So you say, yes, I love Jesus, and I don't love Jesus. Yes, I both love Jesus, and I don't love Jesus. Now, people might say, blah, 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 blah. Well, Jesus is like clapping, you know. Jesus is both clapping and not clapping, if to put it in an expression. Jesus is both clapping for this and not clapping for this, to keep practicing. But also we know that in a non-defined, abstract way, Jesus is truly clapping to hear this. You know, because yeah, practice, 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 practice. What I want is practice. What Jesus wants is practice. He doesn't want any determinative statement from us like, yes, I truly do love Jesus. He's saying, whoa, 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 where's the practice there? I told you to practice. Didn't I say when I left you that my command to you is practice, 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 practice? Don't idolize or worship me. I did not tell you to do that. I told you to practice. And he did. And all those parables he gave out in stories, you know, he's saying, you know, the master went away, he left the house in control, you know, the servants take care of it, you got to take care of it in the right way, make sure everything. And so when I come back, you know, I gave someone some money and I told you to invest it wisely, or I told you to take care of the vineyards, and, you know, whatever. It's all about, he says, when I come back, you have better been practicing and not idolizing me or worshiping me, okay? He said, I'm going to leave. It's better for you that I leave. So you don't try to develop a cult around me and idolize me. Listen to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will tell you how to practice. So Jesus wants us practicing. This is why he's the great rabbi, the great teacher. He wants us practicing, including saying, yes, I love Jesus, and no, I don't love Jesus. Yes, I both love Jesus and don't love Jesus. And Jesus saying, right on, right on, right on. There's someone who's practicing. Yes. And from a practice standpoint, we say, yes and not yes. 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 So do I feel by doing this, by saying, yes, I both love Jesus and I don't love Jesus, do I feel like that somehow Jesus is going to judge me and say, oh my gosh, what's wrong with that guy? I thought he just said he loved me. Now he says he doesn't love me. It's terrible. yeah, I can't trust him. I can't help him out. He's beyond help, this one, you know. Or, wow, he's got a long way to go. That's sad, you know. Or, huh, lost a lot of status, you know, with me. Is that really what's happening? Or is it the opposite? He's saying, wow, here's someone that's saying yes and not yes. Yes and not yes. And he's saying, finally, I got someone practicing. Thank God for that. All glory to God for that. All glory to God that someone is actually practicing and not idolizing and not idolizing and not idolizing. But you don't practice by getting rid of Jesus. You say, well, who the hell is Jesus? You know, why have to use that? No, because that's just the opposite. It's the same mistake in a negative form. That's saying no. Okay, that's not practicing. That's not that. So I'm not going to throw Jesus to the side of them and say, ah, Jesus, you know, historically a bunch of idols been made of you, and, you know, we need to get beyond that. You know, it's just, no, of course not. That's the same mistake in just a negative format. Instead of saying yes, 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 now you're saying no, that's not practicing. That's intellect, that's pleasing the intellect. That's idolizing the intellect. That's idolizing definition. That's trying to bring about our own death. So we're saying yes and no, yes and no. If you want to say no and yes, no and yes. But I like to lead off with the positive, okay? Because that gives a better conveyance of honoring. So yes and no, yes and no. Yes and no, yes and no, yes and no, yes and no. Yes, I love Jesus and I don't love Jesus. I both love Jesus and don't love Jesus. But these are absolutes. I'm not saying that it's somewhere in the middle. See, this is very important. I'm not trying to say some compromise like, well, you know, I'm saying I absolutely love Jesus and I don't absolutely love Jesus. Okay. You can say that. Yes, I absolutely love Jesus and I absolutely don't love Jesus. Make it absolute. Make it absolute. Otherwise, you're going to try and get into honoring content which doesn't exist. Compromise is trying to honor content which is no content, trying to honor zero content. So, yes, I absolutely love Jesus, and no, I absolutely don't love Jesus. Both. Yes, I both absolutely love Jesus and absolutely don't love Jesus. This is the most potent form then of practicing. And so Jesus says, he said, when I come back, I want to find you at practicing. I don't want to find you worshiping. I want to find you practicing. I don't want to find you worshiping, and I don't want to find you carousing. I don't want to find you idolizing, nor do I want to find you carousing. I want to find you practicing. When I come back, I'm going to look and say, who is practicing? Who is practicing? Who can relate with me as a friend instead of an idol or negating, as either, neither an idol nor an enemy? Neither an idol nor an enemy, but a friend. And this is what Jesus said. He came back around the 1st of May, 2:15, and he said, I'm here, and I come back to simply, my purpose is to relate with all of you as a friend. Now, who wants to relate, you see? So, this practicing frees us up from both enmity and idolatry. Neither enmity nor idolatry. So, yes, I absolutely love Jesus, and I'm both absolutely love Jesus and absolutely don't love Jesus. Yes, I'm both absolutely abiding in pure spaciousness and absolutely not abiding in pure spaciousness. See, these are absolute forms. So we're being absolute and abstract and absolute, but still keeping the form that honors the in definition, the form of our creativity. Okay, our creativity of using concepts and words and symbols. We're honoring our creativity with symbols here, and yet zeroing out. We're not trying to honor zero content here, and we're honoring abstraction, which is really truth. Truth is perfectly abstract. And we could say, yeah, I'm both abiding in perfect abstraction and not abiding in perfect abstraction. Yes, I'm both abiding in perfect abstraction and not abiding in perfect abstraction. Yes, I am both absolutely abiding in pure abstraction and absolutely not abiding in pure abstraction. Okay, so you see how we're developing this practice. Yes, I am both absolutely abiding in pure abstraction and absolutely not abiding in pure abstraction. So if we meet Jesus, we might say, yeah, Jesus, yes, I'm both very happy to see you and not very happy to see you. I'm both very happy to meet you and not happy to meet you. And he'd say, yes and no, yes and no, yes and no. He's like, and probably just laugh, you know, just laugh. All you could, you know, just like, ah, just divine laughter. Jesus, it's both absolutely wonderful to see you and absolutely not wonderful to see you. Jesus, it's both absolutely wonderful to see you and absolutely not wonderful to see you. Now, do you think Jesus start crying and says, "Oh my gosh, is this the welcome I get? This is absolutely terrible. My God, I haven't gotten through to this idiot." You know, is that what's going to happen? Or is Jesus going to say, just like, smile? Just, yeah. Don't need to say anything. I'll just be silent. Say, ah. And I know that maybe none of us have ever even imagined that we could use terms and concepts and words and express this way. It was just a vague hope for me, you know, like an ancient memory. Like an ancient memory, like, yeah, I know one time I could do that, you know, but maybe it's dead, maybe it's rotted away and you know, it's just the bones are lost and the animals have even eaten the bones, it's all gone. And yet now here it is, here it is. And so it's a shock. Oh my gosh, I can honor my creativity in this way. So it has to be a shock. To those who are just ignoring it, they just say, oh, this is stupid, you know, nothing to see here. But those who can really, you know, tune into this. It has to be a shock. It has to be a shock. Now, there's some who still in the intellect try to play the role of the intellect not being shocked. But we're not concerned about the intellect being shocked or not. We are spirit. We are spirit, and the spirit that's being shocked. We're just... This is how we're relating to the intellect now. That's it. We're not asking how the intellect feels about anything. We need to know the intellect's just a symbol. So we're saying this is the way now we are now dealing with definition. There's a better point. This is how we spirit, this is how I am now as spirit dealing with definition. Expressing. This is how I'm expressing definitionally. And from that, then you do feel the wow. Like you're 8 miles high. And not likely to touch down. We don't need a soft landing because we're not landing. To bring in the great Buddha to this, again, he said, the wise are already on the other side. And we can put it in, we don't need a soft landing because we're not landing. We're both landing and not landing, actually. To put it in even better terms, practicing terms, yes, I'm both landing and not landing. We are both landing and not landing. And Imagine if you're up on this plane, up among beautiful clouds, and you say, "Yeah, I'm both going to land and not land. We're both landing and not landing here on this trip. This is a trip that is both, we both land and don't land. We absolutely land and absolutely don't land." How does that feel? Maybe it feels like you don't even need the airplane at all. Yeah, I both need the airplane and don't need the airplane. The dog said woof right there. Buddha, Christ, Buddha. If it's just a way of honoring the form of symbols by attaching a symbol to what is has no definition at all. You see. So I say, yes, I am both the Christ and not the Christ. You can say that. Or you can say, yes, I'm both the Buddha and not the Buddha. Now, Jesus is back and wants us practicing. Does that mean the only practice we can use is the name Jesus? No. No, he wants us practicing. The symbols don't matter. It's how we're practicing the symbols that matters. So we can say, yes, I am absolutely the Buddha mind. I am both absolutely the Buddha mind and absolutely not the Buddha mind. For those of you who have a comfort level with Buddhism, you know. Yes, absolutely. And you can even use that with Jesus if you want to. Being a Buddhist, you can say, yes, I am both absolutely the Christ and absolutely not the Christ. And if it encourages you, you absolutely have my permission to do so. Absolutely. A spiritual high. I'm both absolutely on a spiritual high and absolutely not on a spiritual high. Okay. Say it that way. Keep practicing. In other words, don't get stuck in not practicing. Everything is grist for the mill. Why should you stop? We get it, though. I mean, the meta message is we get there's no content. So we get that the glass is half full. We get it. But I keep flipping the script into practicing here, which is, you know, this is a helpful role. So, yes, I'm both absolutely on a spiritual high and absolutely not on a spiritual high. Now, for those who are, you know, whatever direction you're pulled in, whatever it may be, turn it into an absolute. Say, yes, I'm both absolutely this and absolutely not this. I'm not going to pull all possible examples into it. It could be a little bit too reverberating here. So that, you know, there's some pragmatism that I can employ. But you know what I'm saying. You know what I'm saying. Whatever it is that you take what you think is the very highest and the very best, assert that you're both absolutely that and absolutely not that. Okay, whatever it may be. If you're a pagan, if you're an atheist, and you know, whatever it may be, it's okay. doesn't matter. Only the practice matters that we're using here. It can be used in any which way, you see. Yes, I'm both absolutely this and absolutely not this. Yes, I both absolutely love this and I absolutely don't love this. If you're a non-dualist, you can use this or that. Yes, I both absolutely am that and absolutely am not that. Okay? Yes, I both absolutely am that and absolutely am not that. You can use this format, you see, for the non-dualists. Don't think I was going to leave you out of it, right? No. You get to practice too.
The non-dualists say, well, who's there to practice, you know?
Well, let me put it this way. If you're not like Ramana Maharshi, you know, then you need to practice.
There's still a belief in a practicer, right?
There's just a negative form. There's a belief in a non-practicer. So yes, I'm both absolutely the practicer and absolutely not the practicer. Yes, there's both absolutely a practicer and absolutely not a practicer. Okay, this is what you're called to, all right? Do it that way.
I hope this is recording. Yeah, it is. Great. Great. Yeah.
I never know when it will stop. It's gone completely buggy now. It's gone rogue. This program has gone rogue. And so it stops whenever it wants to stop. I just figure the Holy Spirit is taking it over. And, you know, the Holy Spirit says, that's enough. It stops.
Remember, we're not trying to figure out how the intellect feels at all. We are telling ourselves how we're going to honor our form, okay? Symbols. We're deciding how we're honoring, and we're honoring it this way.
So the intellect absolutely both is and isn't. The intellect both absolutely is and absolutely isn't. I both absolutely am and absolutely am not. I both absolutely am and absolutely am not. I both absolutely am and absolutely am not. And this is the honoring of the intellect, honoring of our attempt to define what we are. This is it. And to practice to say, this both absolutely is it and absolutely isn't it. See, in pragmatic terms, what is it is that this both absolutely is it and absolutely isn't it. And we understand we're coming from a glass half full standpoint here, right? So we're not apologizing for this at all. We're not apologizing for disrupting this sheer arrogant funeral.
The in memoriam gather, the gathering in memoriam of spirit. Here lies spirit. We're gathered here to memorialize the wonderful existence that spirit had in mourning now that the loss of spirit. You know, this is what's going on, the PC people. Perfectly corrupt pharmaceutical culture, perfectly corrupt peculiar culture, PC, peculiar culture. The poor Claire culture, you know. I'm weeping, I'm so terrible, so I feel so impoverished, my spirit has died. This is horrible. Please don't laugh. It just makes it hurt even more. It just brings up those terrible memories of the time we, all the great times that spirit we had with spirit now. Please don't laugh. Please don't be happy. It just makes me feel terrible because it's gone forever now. I need to just be sad with me, you know, and don't say anything that might bring back those wonderful memories. I just have to put them to rest. I'm poor Claire here, and I want you to honor me, my mourning, you know, please. Yeah. Sorry, Claire, poor Claire. I just don't have the time to be perfectly frank. I just don't have the time to be perfectly politically correct for you. I gotta move on. But this is literally, you know, the backlash that is there. And I had this in the dream, not last night, the night before. There's this, a poor Claire, poor Clairite, a lady of mourning, in mourning, so to speak, was like just screaming, you know. I guess she's like screaming in grief, I guess, to try to shut me up. It froze me. It hit me so strong. She was just this extreme, I call that a shrieking or screaming, but now I see it's actually grief, you know, wailing, screaming in grief, trying to shut me up, you see, and it put me under great shock, actually. You know what the PC crowd says, you know, if you want to, hey, you know, if you, you know, we can't have you being authentic here, but if you want to pretend to be authentic, go have sex, you know, go take drugs, go rock out, you know, that's okay with us, but don't dare have an authentic tone. Don't dare have an authentic tone. You can have a fake authentic tone, but not a real authentic tone. So go fake it, go fake it, go fake it. You know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, it's all faking it. It's all fake authenticity, you know. So this is what this lady in grief was trying to impulse me into, you know. It's like, how dare you? I'm in such terrible grief here.
If someone, yeah, well, we're not going to lose this important consideration because this is what's going on. Wow. Whew.
It's like my back is being like rearranged somehow. It's all out of whack one way and then another way, and crack, 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 crack. Got a pain in the neck on the left here. Very, you know, it's trying to tighten up on me. Oh, man. So, but it's important that we've been sitting still here for the most part, is to sit still, even when you have the pain in the neck and some. Don't rub it. Don't, you know, try to do, you know, we did about an hour and 20 minutes of just straight out, flat out, witnessing here, honoring. What are we doing? We're honoring our creativity is what we're doing, actually. So we might say, how to the lady in mourning, how dare you try to disrupt my honoring of creativity? That's very politically incorrect to do that. How dare you try and disrupt the honoring of our creativity here? It's the honoring of God. How dare you disrupt my honoring of God with your faux funeral, you know, your faux funeral and your faux grief and your faux mourning. How dare you do that? So you flip the script. Well, quite frankly, we're not going to allow you to do that. Yeah. That's all we need to say. See, we got to get in a voice now. Quite frankly, we're not going to allow you to do that. And we're not going to allow you to sick this, your dogs on us, your thugs on us. We're not going to allow you to do that. Quite frankly, we're not going to allow you to do that.
So this is the most fun I've had, you know, in my entire life, right here, right now. Absolutely is the most fun I've had. Yeah, actually you have more fun with your clothes on than the clothes off, you know that? Absolutely. The other is just fake. This is real fun. This is true fun. We do it with our clothes on, fully clothed, fully still, fully quiet like this, just still, yeah. This is like drastic fun. This is fun. Flipping the script like this is, that's true fun. And the fun is just reverberating like a wow. Wow, this is fun. I didn't know I'd ever have fun again, really. I mean, the way this funeral's been going, I think most of us are thinking, maybe I'm never gonna really have fun again, ever. I'm just gonna have this dreary, you know, pretending to have fun. Dreary, boring, flat, stale crumbs. Oh yeah, I think I'm having fun, yeah, right. We all smile, and then you look at the person, they don't think you're looking, it's like they're frowning, you know, they're frowning. But we're not really frowning here at all, are we? In the wow, you're not frowning. Just stay in that, I'm not frowning, wow. The frown-free zone. Yeah, just dwell in the frown-free zone for a while here. I'm having more fun than Trump is having, actually. Not to compare, but I'm telling you, this is even more fun. I'm just dwelling in the frown-free zone. And quite frankly, I can't allow anybody to, you know, dishonor this. Just abide in that frown-free zone. You don't have to be smiling. It's enough to not be frowning, right? There's no frown in the wow. Full stop in the frown-free zone. What a day today it is in California. Holy cow. I mean, if you could bottle this weather, you could sell it all over the world. It's intoxicating, the weather, in a certain way, actually. Maybe it's just me. The atmosphere around me is feeling intoxicating. It takes the frown off your face. It's really neither this nor that, the weather in California. It's both this and that, and not this. Yeah, it's both this and not this. It's absolutely both this and absolutely not this. It's both absolutely this and absolutely not this. It defies definition to a large extent, actually. At least what I'm experiencing. It's like the landscape of familiarity is being completely rearranged. And I don't try to bring it to the level of symbols. Just let it happen. Whatever's happening is happening. I don't bring it to the level of energy or symbols or anything like that. It's just sort of like a reverberation, and there's, you know, the play of the reverberation is, I try not to pay attention. It's enough to say it's whatever it's playing as, just let it play as that. I'm still focused on practice, pragmatic practice. And this is where our focus needs to be. Don't get into the body. Don't try to get into the subtleness of it. Don't try to get into that. Stay focused on the pragmatism of practicing. And that will automatically do whatever play needs to happen will automatically happen. I'm experiencing now is just, you might call it heavenly. Cannot be defined. It both can be defined and can't be defined. Keep practicing, right? Yes, it both can be defined and cannot be defined. Yes, this is both absolutely definable and absolutely non-definable. The atmosphere I'm experiencing, yes, it is both absolutely definable and absolutely non-definable. So when you've done a very good practice, you'll reach this frown-free zone where it's just wow, the wow, you just realize, wow, this is extraordinary. This is both absolutely definable and absolutely non-definable. You see how wonderful these ruffians are. They say, one pushes you, the other pushes you. One says, yes, this is both absolutely definable, and the other one pushes you, is to say, and this is absolutely non-definable. And this is absolutely definable, and this is absolutely non-definable. You get pushed back. One pushes you, say, this is absolutely non-definable. And the other one grabs you and gets you and pushes back to say, this is absolutely definable. And the other one pushes you and say, this is absolutely non-definable. This is absolutely definable. And this is absolutely non-definable. So you get pushed back and forth, back and forth. And you're just like some mosh pit. It's a wonderful mosh pit. You're getting pushed like this. And, oh. And it's like, and you're up in the air saying, oh my God, there's no frown on my face here. It's like a spiritual mosh pit. And what do they call it? Body surfing above the mosh pit where they push surf the person above the crowd. You know, it's like the atmosphere here is like some exquisite wine, if you want to use that. California, you can use that as symbol. I don't drink wine, but if you listen to them rhapsodize about wine, you could say right now that the atmosphere is this incredibly fine wine. It has all these overtones and undertones and side tones and non-tones. Tones and non-tones, overtones and undertones, side tones here, side tones there, all tones and no tones. It's like you're drinking in some fine wine right now, you know, for free. I did a great effort to evangelize California in certain ways. Maybe this is coming back to me. Maybe this is the fruit. If you have eyes to see, so to speak, if you're willing to tune into it. This almost feels like the death-free realm that I experienced, the atmosphere right now. Now we're told that this winter comes the deluge, yeah, but we've had 4 years of this exquisiteness, you know, to drink it in, to get ready for the death-free realm, really. I mean, this atmosphere now, it does remind me of that. When I was taken there in spirit and experienced a death-free realm, my consciousness was taken there. And this feels quite similar to it. So, Californians, just sit quiet. Don't be missing it by all this vigorous exercise. Just sit quiet. Just experience it. This is what I'd like to do in California. I just to sit and experience the weather. Just experience it. Instead of doing. No. This has an exquisiteness to it. And so we'd say, yes, this is both absolutely exquisite and absolutely not exquisite. And the exquisiteness and the not exquisiteness, right? Is the honoring, and the honoring is the reflection of reality, and reality transcends any definition or non-definition. Both is and it isn't, and neither is it is nor isn't, nor isn't nor is, etc., etc., transcends all definition and all non-definition. But in our honoring, which is an activity, a pragmatic activity, using symbols, we can get this reflection of reality. It's both exquisite and not exquisite. And so there will be this reflection in our mind of reality. And this is what people will experience in our presence. They'll feel something's being reflected here, but I don't know if it's both exquisite and not exquisite. I can't quite define it, you know. And then this is where they need to go into the glasses half full and practice. And they will then start getting the reflection within their own being. Instead of worshiping the candle, light your candle. You see a candle, say, oh, can I light my candle? Yeah, light your candle. The candle's burning, use that to light your candle. I was in church, and we were doing this Easter service where we lit candles, and we came in, and the breeze was blowing out people's candles. I ended up, a lot of people come to me they lit their candle from my candle. A number of people were doing that. I said, oh, that's cool. In fact, that's part of what we do, part of what happens is people do go to other people and get their candles lit like that, and it's a sharing, it's a symbolic thing. I mean, there are good overtones and undertones in religion, you know, there absolutely are. It's not completely dead. It's not. But just remember that Jesus said, I want to find you practicing when I come back. I want you to be very good practitioners when I come back. Neither carousing nor worshiping, idolizing. Practicing. So there is still a little bit of practice, remnants of practice in the church, but not enough. See, this is my declaration. Not enough. Jesus comes back and the church people, he said, what are you doing? He said, you know, I mean, you're like, you're listless, you know. Where's the fire? Where's the light? Where's the reflection? Where's the practicing? You know, you don't say just Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And I say Jesus, no Jesus, Jesus, no Jesus, Jesus, no Jesus, Jesus, no Jesus. Hi Jesus, not hi Jesus. Hi Jesus, not hi Jesus. Hi Jesus, not hi Jesus. You know, be practicing like that. So the church, of course, they were going to run in. They ran into opposition because those who were conducting the funeral said, "Hey, shut up." go underground. We don't want you here. We're conducting this huge funeral for this memorial gathering for the death of spirit, and you're disrupting our gathering. So you go into the catacombs. And then when they came out, they said, well, if you're willing to tone it down, you know, we'll into a compromise area, no absolutes, then we'll, you know, we can put up with that. No absolutes. And you got to punish those in your religion who are into the absolutes, or, you know, drive them into Nubia or the desert and get out. You know, don't hang around our memorial gathering. I mean, that's very, very non-PC. It's very dishonorable. You're dishonoring the Vestal Virgins. You know, nobody can do that. And we say, well, quite frankly, we simply don't have the time to completely allow for that. for the complete, perfect, non-dishonoring of the Vestal Virgins. We just don't have time for that. So that's what we could say. Quite frankly, we don't have the time to completely honor the Emperor, nor to completely dishonor the Emperor. Yes, I'm absolutely honoring the Emperor and absolutely not honoring the Emperor. And let's leave it at that. So, the memorial gathering ushers and functionaries, you know, basically tried to tone down Christianity. So they've been trying to tone it down for 2,000 years. So they have toned it down a lot. But you can still feel the echoes. You can. When you go to church, I attend Catholic Mass. I'm not a Catholic, but I attend it because I want to gauge the whole situation. You see, I'm just gauging the whole totality of the history of honoring everything that's taking place. And you can feel the echoes, the ancient echoes echoing faintly still. You can feel it. There's still faint echoes there. Even though our priest, just before leaving, instead of getting up to say, Our Father who art in heaven, he said, Hail Mary, full of grace. Whoops. Then he goes, whoop, whoop. You're like, what? I think it's time I better quit. I mean, I'm a... You know, everybody was shocked. Like, what? Yeah, why did he say that? And, of course, the funeral directors have got to him. They say, shh, 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 shh. We've got these ladies in grief here. What are you doing? Saying Our Father. You can't say Our Father anymore. We got to perfectly honor these grieving, the grieving widow. Got to honor the grieving widow, my gosh. And her sisters and aunties and everyone, they're all in collective grief, terrible mourning. We got to honor that, you know. So he, you know, has gotten so much into the church that he even, that came out, you know. And that was curtains for him. He said, I got to go off. And, curtains for the church. I mean, that actually was symbolizing the end of the church, because Jesus is back, and he's bringing freshness with him. So those who are tuning to Jesus sound fresh. They feel fresh. There's a freshness to it, right? There's a livingness to it. There's a freshness to it. There's exquisiteness to it. It has both undertones and overtones, and neither this nor that. Both this and not this. Both this and not this. So the church age is ended. It's finished. And he retired. Very good priest. He really cared. There was some authenticity to him. Some of the priests, there's still some authenticity, echoes of authenticity in them. Amazing. Great job the church did. I mean, just standing up to the funeral directors here, you know, is very difficult. How many Christians have been martyred throughout history, actually? Standing up to the funeral director, funeral directors, and the, you know, hey, how dare you change the tone of our mourning here, mourning the death of spirit. How dare you? Yeah, what a great history. And now the one that started it all, Jesus, is back. And you can feel it, the freshness. It's like, wow. I can do it right here, right now. I don't really have to be in a church, actually. That's why in that dream I left the church and I was walking down the hill on the street, and that's where those ruffians were. Who? Divine ruffians. So it may be that the church, you know, I have declared the church age is finished. It's finished. So you can still feel the echoes in church, but we have something better now. More than echoes, we have actual full voice, you know, the singing. We're singing it now. Not getting some ancient echo of a song that was sung long ago that is still faintly bouncing around the world. We're now, the voice, the song is now being sung freshly. Again, Jesus is back singing his song. Singing his song of let's honor creativity and then move on. So being a music aficionado of the highest degree, I was able to hear this song. I said, hey, wait a minute, you know, there's a better song being sung. This is even better music. This is divine music here. Let's listen to divine music. Recently, I think I posted a video of that. I may have taken it off, but I was singing so well. I was singing so well. I was really singing George Jones off his chair, which is, you know, I mean, he's, you can do it because he's probably very drunk, and he might fall to the ground under the table. But I was, you know, I was really singing him under the table, actually. You know, I gave him his due, saying, no, I'm just right there with you. But I was actually a little bit better. And because I had more authenticity even. Jones had a lot of authenticity. But it was the authenticity of the church. Echoes. He was able to tune into the echoes of Christian authenticity. Did it better than anyone. But now I was singing with the authenticity of Jesus having returned, and this is a fresh authenticity. So I was actually out singing George Jones for a little while. I don't practice any more singing, so I my voice kind of got tired. But I was like, wow, I haven't sung since. I'm just sort of abiding in that wow of that, you know, that's enough. You don't have to really sing. The wow is better than singing, even. It's a means to an end. It's not an end in itself, actually. Now, part of my journey towards authenticity was the PC culture was so severe here. The grieving widow and her sisters and daughters and mother-in-law and aunties and, you know, the whole massive congregation of the weeping widows. They're so good at it, you know. And the ladies are distraught. Was so strong that I was not able to directly affirm Jesus, you know, the freshness of Jesus. Hey, he's coming back, and so we got to get ready for that. And because they said, my God, you're dishonoring these ladies. You're being so disturbed. So I was not able to do that. So I had to use a woman as a temporary device. And Anna, my ma, was lent herself to me for that purpose, to say, hey, you know, I understand that you know, you're not yet able to just say, to dismiss, you know, the ladies, the grieving ladies. You have to honor them. So, but if you say, well, I'm being authentic with this woman, then it takes a little of that edge off, you know. It took a little bit of the edge off of that. And so, well, I'm not being dishonorable to a woman. She's not bothered by me. That kind of thing. She's not bothered by this authenticity. You know, so why should you? So it gave me a little wiggle room there. Whereas if I'd used a man like Jesus, for instance, That wouldn't play. That didn't play at all. They'd come down on you. But that was a temporary expedient. So I did some songs at that time. I went through a period where I composed a lot of songs, you know, praising the Virgin Mary, praising, you know, the idea of the female who is not grieving, the non-grieving female, so to speak, in order to get away with authenticity. That I had to use this contrivance to get away with authenticity, you know. But it's Jesus is really the one that is back. So I was listening to those songs last night. And like, my gosh, you know, the authenticity of them is just fabulous, fabulous. But at this time, we do need to go the full thing. And we don't need to use this, you know, this crutch, so to speak, and say, oh yeah, ladies, I'm sorry. But, you know, I was, after all, you know, being authentic with a woman. So I hope you're not too upset with me, kind of thing. You know, we don't need that wiggle room anymore. Okay. All thanks and praise for that which suggested, why don't you try it this way for a while, and that'll get you moving at least in the right direction. So I did do these songs, compositions, and they're fabulous. I was listening on YouTube last night. I mean, for authenticity, I said, my God, I just need authenticity. I couldn't find it. I can't find authenticity in music. I cannot. That's not authentic. It's weak. It's weak. And so I actually had to go back to the songs I composed in 19 and composed and performed. I performed all instrumentation, plus did all the recording, everything. And I listened to those, and it was like a breath of fresh air. I said, my God, this is very authentic. You can feel the authenticity on it. But even though I used like the term like the Virgin Mary, used Anandamayi Maa, for instance, like that, I felt like I had no choice at that point. I wasn't strong. I couldn't push back. So, you know, I couldn't
be like Trump, you know, is now. I mean, we were just like, you know, we were so pinned down.
You know, it was just a complete blitzkrieg at the time. Absolute blitzkrieg of political correctness. And basically, you couldn't really say, well, this is how it's going to go. You know, but now we know how it goes. And so, you know, now we can say, hey, now I don't have the time to be perfectly perfectly politically correct. And I'm not going to allow you to interfere with my honoring of creativity. It's not allowable. You know, you just couldn't. Nobody was saying that, actually. Couldn't say it. We were under such a blitzkrieg. It was just unbelievable. And you still had the whole sex, drugs, rock and roll thing being pushed on everybody ferociously. And yet the internet was yet to come in the way it is now, you know. Smartphones are yet, all this stuff, you know, that they were saying, look, we got such great stuff. You're going to love fake authenticity. But now, in hindsight, you can see, oh, it's all just fake authenticity, you know. Forget it. I'm not going to allow that to interfere with my honor and creativity. So at this point, we can actually relate directly with Jesus, actually. We really can. Or if you're like a Hindu or something, you can actually relate directly with Anandamayi Maa, if you want to put it that way. Whatever your way is, you could. But for in this Judeo-Christian tradition, which is really as old a tradition as there is in the world, we talk about Vedic culture going back. What about Jewish culture? How far that goes back too, you know? And so this Judeo-Christian heritage that we have, you know, this is our context. So I say I can relate directly with Jesus now. I don't have to pull any punches anymore. So I'm not highlighting Anandamayi Maa or the archetype of the Virgin Mary in the right way, meaning the Immaculate Virgin, so to speak, with no frown at all. No frown at all, you see. You don't need to use the feminine form of that at all. Because what we have to stand up to is the ladies in grief. You know, that is what's being used against us. Okay, so we cannot pull any punches anymore. But those songs, I mean, gosh. You know, I was just like, it revived me. Revived me from all like a death-like state. I was trying to find some music on YouTube, which has got just all the music, you know, there is, right? And just didn't do it. I was listening to music from the 60s. It just was flat. And noticeably flat. All of it. I don't care who you're talking about. You know, you cannot point out one artist to me that doesn't sound flat right now. If you go back and listen to their music, it's flat. It is flat. It's not the song of salvation. It's hedged in. It's like reserved. It's kind of like a band playing at a funeral, you know. It's like saying, well, you know, let me not disturb those ladies, you know. I gotta be careful I don't disturb the ladies. They're in such grief. I don't want to disturb the ladies' grief. You know, but now we're saying, oh, by all means, disturb the ladies' grief. It's not really about that. It's how dare those ladies pretending to be in grief, demand to disturb my honoring of creativity. How dare they? It's not allowable. We flip the script here. You know, I'd rather listen to my own singing than any of those other vocalists, you know, even though it's ragged. Because I just, you know, just started out. Actually, now I can sing way better if the Spirit moves me to do so, which it usually does not, and which is fine with me. But I still sang. I still like the authenticity of the voice, even though there's raggedness to it, and drops out a few times, it doesn't quite hit the note here, you know. It's all just spontaneous. I mean, I just composed and made them and said, okay, let me just see if I can sing it this way, and, you know, it's like that. Not a professional singer. Was a complete, you know, just an amateur dilettante. Not really, though, because of previous lives. So I said, I can get back on the bike and ride a little bit, but I'm not really into it that much. But it did help me a little bit with authenticity, first finding the voice, singing the voice. But I had to, you know, instead of doing what I'm doing now, which is practicing, which is way more authentic than singing, actually. This is way more authentic, what we're doing here. And Jesus is the one that encouraged us to use this type of practice. Okay, so he is the one who is bringing the right practice. A lot of people are very sensitive. They never think when doing that of their idol. You know, there's a lot of idols. A lot of idols dressed up in dresses. A lot of idols dressed up in trousers. A lot of idols dressed up in various ways. You know, the idol will never tell you to practice this way. Never, never, never. But Jesus does tell us, say, I both absolutely love Jesus and I absolutely don't love Jesus, you see. Yes, I both absolutely love Jesus and absolutely don't love Jesus. And Jesus is the one who's telling us to practice in this way. An idol will never tell us to practice this in this way, no matter how beautiful the idol may seem. The wigs, the ornamentation, the dresses, the perfume, the makeup, the flowers, the throne, the singing, the dancing, but they will never tell you to practice in this way. An idol will not. And yet the idols are so ferocious now that at least I felt like I needed to at least give them, you know, some just due, you know, and I did not have the strength to dismiss them the way I'm able to now. But it's fine. You know, when you're in Rome, sometimes you have to do as the Romans do a little bit. Doing here? Still trucking along. That's great. You feel, see, the length of these, you get full blast. Why not? You're going to use your 24 hours somehow. And if you're not using it this way, it's very likely it's being used to pay attention to the funeral. I mean, there's a massive state funeral going on in the United States. It's been going on ever since the mortician took over in the White House. It's like, okay, great, people, finally we can get to what we really need to do, is hold this wonderful funeral for the death of spirit. Yeah, we've been delaying and procrastinating for so long, but finally, you know, we got the mortician there who's able to conduct the
the memorial ceremony here. My gosh.
Mortician in chief.
And of course, we're honoring that creativity too by what we're doing. Absolutely, we are. It's just we're existing. There's no content at all, but we do honor it. We do honor that creativity. He's a very, very great display of creativity from the mortician in chief. Absolutely, I laugh at it. I see the humor in it. I appreciate it. I appreciate the artistry of it. Absolutely, I do. Very good actor. He's acting the role of mortician in chief.
And of course, all the ladies in waiting, the ladies in mourning. He's got the whole group of ladies in mourning around him, you know, and he's telling us, "Shh, don't dare dishonor these ladies. They're so grief stricken. Death of spirit is so grief stricken them so badly. Don't say a word. Just if you can't say something good about them, don't say anything at all." You know, that's PC. Hey, if you can't say a good word about the death of spirit, don't say anything at all. If you can't honor the grieving of these ladies, you know, don't say anything at all. Please. That's very disrespectful. Very dishonorable. Very, you know, sexist and racist and terrible. You know, it's just terrible, 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 terrible. And I say, no, what's terrible is you're demanding that I not honor creativity. That's what's terrible. So stop it. I don't have time for such nonsense. No, but none of us have time for that nonsense right now. Maybe you should do a Trumpism. Just say, "Hey, mortician in chief, you're fired. You are absolutely fired. That's it. We're done. That's it. We're done. We're done with you. That's it." This is just a rerun now on television, right? This is all just a rerun that's taking place now. We don't have to watch the rerun. No need for it. Don't have the time for reruns. Jesus is back, you know. What are we paying attention to? Some mortician in chief. You know, we're finished. We're finished, that's it. Moving on to Jesus here. And what's Jesus about? Practice, practice, practice. Right practice, right practice, right practice. He says, "When I come back, I want to see you practicing." I don't want you paying attention to some memorial gathering for spirit. I want you practicing. And when he said, "Okay, who's ready to relate?" You know, and you relate through practice. I said, "Okay, I'll do it." And I looked around. Everybody else is like, and they're like saying, "Wow, I don't know. I don't know if I can take my attention off this funeral here. I mean, I don't want to disrupt the funeral. Somebody might think that I'm not paying attention or not respecting the dead. Come on." Yeah, Jesus, I'd like to relate, but I need to respect the dead too. I mean, you know, I don't know what to do. These ladies might say that and get upset with me.
Or are those the thugs that protect them? You know, that stand around, make sure, you know, make sure everybody's respecting their grief. Are you respecting their grief? Are you respecting? Okay, you're respecting their grief. Oh, you aren't. Okay. I'm looking at you. Yeah. Respecting the grief? Okay, you better respect their grief. Are you respecting the grief? Well, the goddess is so heartbroken, you know. Her true love spirit has died. You know, now she's just wailing and mourning. Are you respecting her grief? Well, how long is she going to grieve? Well, hundreds of years, you know. This is going to go on for a long time, 238 years, you know. She's going to be grieving. But after the grief is over, then finally we can move on, you know. So there's all these assistants, you know, grief assistants. Grief assistance. Right? We start using this terminology, a mortician and see ladies in grief, the goddess in grief, and her ladies in waiting in grief, and the grief assistance.
The Greek, the grief advocates and the Greek assistants and the Greek defendants. Grief defendants. Let's make sure we're all on the same page here. We're all grieving together now. If we just all grieve together, we'll get over the grief faster, you see. This is what their message is. Come on now. I know it's terrible. The Spirit's diet is awful, but if we all grieve together, we can get over this grief. Eventually we'll get over the grief, and then we'll be able to move on from it. In fact, it'll be better than ever, because then we'll be prime in the new prime creator, you see. They're not saying that because that's not kosher, you know. It's not kosher to say it right now. It might get people thinking, saying, oh, wait a minute, you know, maybe that's all a scam. You're trying to be the new prime creator. So no, they keep that under wraps. But not here. We know all about it. This faux memorial ceremony. Grief assistants. The grief assistants, grief defenders, grief organizers. We've got the grief organizers, grief defenders, grief assistants. There's a whole big bureaucracy of this memorial gathering. It's a massive bureaucracy because they said, together, we can get over our grief. Absolutely. Everybody on the same page here. Come on. You owe it to those poor grieving goddess who's heartbroken that her favorite is now died. Spirit has died. Gee, how terrible. You got to respect that. You can't disrespect that. Meanwhile, Jesus says, hey, I'm alive. What are you talking about? I'm perfect. I'm great. There's not a speck of death in me at all. Never was. Never has been. I feel fresh as a daisy. Come on. What's going on? Pay attention here. I'm back. Why are you not relating with me? What's going on? Are you not practicing? Have you not been practicing? I mean, being able to relate to me is a sign that you've been practicing. Whoops. Yeah, well, get going. Come on. You can get going. Let's get going here. Just stay in the frown-free zone here for a little while. See, the more you stay in the frown-free zone, the more you get used to it. And the more you can entertain that which brings you into that frown-free zone. Right? It works like that. It's a positive spiral we're engaged in here. Now, I'm just doing some flipping the script now instead of practicing, right? It'd give us a little break from it. You know, I could flip everything into a practice, but, you know, the wow has been very intense here, so I respect the wow. Frown-free zone. Now, we're in a big rush. I'm in a big rush. I got a terrible situation, apparently. I mean, very potentially catastrophic with no income coming in. And so, I got to get going on this. There's a big rush. Absolutely, there is. And so, we're pushing things. Don't worry about all those other videos I put. Whatever I put up, this is just filler. It's filler, you know. And you might feel like a need to, like, maybe I need to, like, you know, honor the past a little bit, you know. So, okay, it's there. That's fine. If you don't need the filler, you don't need the filler. It's okay. Absolutely, it's okay. I put up A Course in Miracles lessons. Okay. 1 through 301. Fine. That's great. I might even, sometimes I go back and look at those. Yeah. To honor the creativity. Absolutely. But we have this fresh practice now, which is just awesome. Absolutely awesome. And so if we can get with that, that's even better. It's even better. But when you want to maybe take a break, say, well, I don't know. Well, there's all this filler, a lot of beautiful graphics. I put up a lot of beautiful stuff. Maybe I'll put up some music, you know, just a filler. See, I understand. I get it. People don't want to watch, that's fine. It's just a filler. Just kind of, you know, it's just there to honor. If you need to use this to honor, that's fine. But we have this practice. Yes, I am both absolutely abiding in pure spaciousness and absolutely not abiding in pure spaciousness. Yes, I am both absolutely abiding in the heart and absolutely not abiding in the heart. And we can put ourselves through that gauntlet. Absolutely we can. The intellect will never do it.
but we're not the intellect, are we? We're not a definition of what we are. We're free of all definition. So that which is free of all definition can definitely put itself through the gauntlet of this practice, but it has to be the will of spirit, not the will of the intellect. Don't ask permission from the intellect, because it'll say no. It will say no. It says, well, let's fake it. Let's fake authenticity. I'm good at that. You know, but it's very dead, isn't it? The intellect's very dead. It's very fake. It's very inauthentic. Even though it can fake it with all sorts of emotion and drama and tears and this and that, you know, right? Faking, oh, I'm the heart, you know. Yeah, I got an intellect. I'm the intellect, but I got a heart. No, I am both absolutely dwelling in the heart and absolutely not dwelling in the heart. Both and neither. I am absolutely both and neither. I am both and neither, absolutely dwelling in the heart and absolutely not dwelling in the heart. If you really want to get even more profound, I am both and neither, absolutely dwelling in the heart and absolutely not dwelling in the heart. I am both and neither, absolutely dwelling in pure spaciousness and absolutely not dwelling in pure spaciousness. You see, this is where it's at. It's both at, both and neither, absolutely where it's at and absolutely not where it's at. This moves us into the frown-free zone very, very effectively. So I do this practice. Now, when I want to go back and honor the past a little bit, I'll look at A Course in Miracles. Those what the practices that Jesus gave there, I will look at those, yes. And it'll say, ah, thank you for that, thank you, that's cool. And just sometimes we go back and listen to some music like back in the 60s, 70s. I mean, there was stuff back then we felt was authentic. It was as much authenticity as we could express back then, you see. But now we have this practice which, you know, brings us into the frown-free zone to an extraordinary way. So as we move on, we still can reference, you know, where we've been from time to time. That is fine. But in going back listening to music, it was flat. I said, wow, this is not enough authenticity for me in that music. There just isn't. I feel like going into a recording studio and, you know, recording some songs just so I can have some music to listen to. But how do you do that? I mean, when I recorded the songs, I said, I can't get anybody. I tried to find musicians. I couldn't get anybody to be authentic as I was being. I just couldn't. So I said, I have to play all the instruments myself, son of a gun. So I just taught myself how to play, you know, how many instruments did I play? My gosh, so many. So many, many, many. Everything. Everything. You know, from harmonica to harmonium to it was some sort of accordion, banjo, you know, pedal steel guitar, rhythm guitar, lead guitar, acoustic guitar, bass guitar, drums, rhythm instruments of all types. It goes on and on. The only thing I didn't play was a violin, I think. I mean, I didn't play trumpet. I got a trumpet and a violin, but I couldn't really, didn't have the time to really play them. I would have liked to have been able to play a trumpet. I like to punch it, and strings. I like that. Put strings, have strings in a brass section. The music is very nice. I just played every instrument. Oh, organ, piano, all keyboards, synthesizer. I taught myself to play everything, all of that. Because I had a tremendous musical background in previous lives. So for me, I felt whatever is musical, I can do it. I just had absolute faith that, can I play harmonica? Of course. Whatever it is, I can do it and do it well. Now, I knew I wouldn't do it that good, of course. You're not, you know, grandiose about it. But I said, that doesn't matter. It's okay. It's the tone of authenticity that's important in the music anyway. It's not the perfection of the polish of the players. It's the tone and authenticity that's important. I actually like the songs better without the drums. Some of the best songs are no drums, no percussion on it at all. I just muted the strings of like a rhythm guitar, And I'm able to give a real punchy kind of, you know, rhythm to the song without even using drums. But drums are great too. You really need a good drummer though. It's hard to make drums sound good unless you're really drumming well, actually. But a really great drummer can, you know, sounds great. A lousy drummer sometimes just gets in the way. Don't even need it. Sounds better without it. Sometimes, you know, more is less in music. Great drummers like Ginger Baker, Keith Moon. Who's the drummer for Blondie? He was like super, super good. I can't remember his name, but drummer for the Rascals was pretty good for his time. And of course, there's all the jazz drummers, all kinds of stuff like that, of course, and if you really want to get into it. But, you know, yeah, Ginger Baker was really, really, really good. So, you know, it sounded great. And so was Jack Bruce, and so was Eric Clapton. They were all three really, really, really good. That's why Cream had this feeling of authenticity to it, you know. It was like, it was ragged, too. They were kind of raggedy in a lot of ways. But when you're young, you're looking for authenticity because you feel the world's inauthentic, it's fake. And you said, oh my gosh, this is going to kill my spirit almost, you know, it's going to suppress it, and I'm going to lose my authenticity. So you're looking for musicians who are authentic, and you're always trying to find the most authentic. Or some are. I mean, I certainly was trying to. Who's the most authentic? Without being contrived authenticity. There's a lot of those who just use authenticity as a shtick, as a contrivance, actually. But no, I mean, the genuine authentic who, you know, it doesn't matter what they're playing, sounds great. Eddie Van Halen's that way. He was not only a great player, but had authenticity, a lot of authenticity to it, actually. It was just, whatever he's playing, it just sounds great. You know, you could hand him a ukulele and he'd sound great. I mean, it doesn't matter. You could hand him the junkiest guitar in the world and he would sound absolutely great. It's not the guitar, really. But he, you know, he had to drink to get free the inhibitions up. You know, a lot of musicians use drugs to free them from inhibitions. And then it becomes a negative spiral because they of course, they sound so great when they're uninhibited. And then when they're not drinking, they're inhibited, they don't sound as great. And it drives them nuts. So they then end up taking more drugs or whatever they're using, and they get a drug problem. Absolutely. If you're a musician, you got to be very, very careful of that. And I don't even advise anyone to be a musician, actually. It's a road to drug abuse is what it really is. Sex, drugs, rock and roll, it's a road to self-destruction. Because the authenticity of music sounds so wonderful, and then you have to, how do you get it back? And it's just, you know, it's horrible. It's absolutely horrible. Every musician knows exactly what I'm talking about. Because when you're on, you know, the authenticity is there. And when you're not on, it's not there. No matter how you try, it's not there. And it just kills you. And you'll do anything to get it back. That's why they have groupies, you know, the musicians. You know, the groupies say, hey, I'll bring your authenticity back, you know. So they got the drugs, they got the groupies, they got, you know, whatever they can to try and bring that authenticity back. And it just, you know, it gets less and less and less and more difficult, you know. And it just doesn't, and they get more and more addicted, and they end up hitting bottom. What did Deborah Harry say of Blondie? Like, half of the people I knew are not even around anymore. In the music scene. Dead. So I don't advise music for anybody, actually. Because you got to be careful even with singing. That's why I don't sing. You know, I don't want to. last time I sang, it was so authentic, it was scary. But then, you know, people hear that, they say, well, I want that authenticity, sing some more, sing some more, sing some more. It's like a drug for them. But that's not where it's at, because you need to practice, right? Spiritual practice is how you get the authenticity. That's how we get the authenticity. You got to light your candle, so you're a light unto yourself. You can't just sit there and idolize or worship somebody, because it goes into idolization and worship if you do that. And that's not where it's at all. Practice is where it's at. Jimi Hendrix was a lot of authenticity there, you know, but he used a ton of drugs, killed him. A lot of those musicians had some authenticity, you know. You can name this one and that one, like Mama Cass, for instance. Some say Jim Morrison. I wasn't, you know, he died, you know. You go on and on and on and on and on and on. So many musicians have bit the dust. Abuse, you know. Trying to get that authenticity back again and again and again and again. So people can, you know, worship it, idolize it, and feel like, oh, I'm getting something. But we're past that now. We're past the whole music scene. Past the whole music scene. We have this freshness now that's coming from Jesus. Reason why I'm able to be fresh like this is because of Jesus, plain and simple. And some of the helpers that helped out. Thank God for that. He's bringing the authenticity back. Course in Miracles from Jesus. It's a breath of authenticity in the stale hell of psychotherapy, psychoanalytic culture that we had back in the 50s and the 60s and the 40s, 50s, 60s. I mean, there was even 70s. I mean, there was this intense PC psychoanalytic culture. And he opened the door. He helped free us from that by, you know, accommodating it to some extent. And so he's bringing back the freshness. And this is beyond musical culture, way beyond it. This is an exquisiteness that music cannot capture, actually. Music only gives faint echoes of it. At best, there's only faint echoes. Just like religion, at best now is a faint echo. Religion's actually more powerful than music, more authentic than music. Music is an attempt to capture the echoes of Christianity, really. I mean, who captured the echoes of Christianity better than anyone? Brian Wilson and the Beach Boys. Absolutely. I mean, you go and listen to Christian music, and I'm hearing, my God, that's what the Beach Boys did. They just stole it. They just stole it. They took it, the doxology from Christianity, the praise and how it was done. Brian Wilson somehow got those echoes of that. I think it was Lutheran or something, but there's no question about it. The progressions, the whole thing, he tuned into the echoes of Christianity and then put it into pop music better than anyone. I love the Beach Boys because you could feel that authentic. You could feel the echoes of Christianity there. I said, there's something there that's just really sacred, you know, even though it's, you know, fun, fun, fun till her daddy takes the T-Bird away. But it was there. Round, round, get around, I get around, absolutely. Exactly what he did. But we're past musical culture now, you see. We used it at best to bridge the times where PC culture, the funeral for spirit became so severe, to bridge back to now where Jesus is back and we're now able to practice directly like this. Yes, I am both and neither, absolutely abiding in pure spaciousness and absolutely not abiding in pure spaciousness. If you want to just get another zap, you know, another buzz, this is it. This is both, and I am both and neither. To use a real strong form, I am both and neither, absolutely abiding in pure spaciousness and absolutely not abiding in pure spaciousness. Zero out the definition, zero out the concepts. And in this automatically cleans the mirror of our being so that reality is reflected. As we're honoring our creativity, we're receiving a reflection of our true being. Okay, it defogs the mirror, as you might, a way to put it. It defogs the mirror. Thank God we've had, this is still going. It defogs the mirror. These practices profoundly defog the mirror. And we need the profundity of defogging the mirror right now. We need it very strong right now. Because the grief of the goddess, to use that term in this context, is so extreme now. It's becoming, the height of her grief is now coming. It's finally struck her that irrevocably spirit has died. The irrevocability of it has finally reached the heart of the goddess. And this is when her intense grief now is to be poured out upon the world, and everyone is to honor this, because, you know, to not honor it would be completely dishonorable. You know, this is when it's happening right now. Right now. One of the ladies in waiting of the goddess in grief, you know, was, you know, assaulted Trump at the debate, right? How dare you? How dare you, you know, interrupt our grief. I'm telling you, I'm ordering you. Basically, she's basically ordering Trump to stand down, is what she really did. There's no question about it. Everybody watching the debate who with at least an echo of authenticity in him recognized. And Trump said, I won't stand down. And all, you know what, hit the fan after that. And those who have stood down said, how dare you not stand down? We're not going to invite you to talk to us. We only invite those who are standing down. So we're going to invite this lady in waiting of the goddess in grief to reassure us that we're doing the right thing by standing down. We're doing the right thing by standing down. Absolutely. Let's get her up on the stage and tell us how great we are in standing down. But Trump, no, he says, I'm not going to stand down. And to those who are standing down, this was like absolute heresy. Disrespecting the goddess's grief at the moment when it's finally striking her of the irrevocable loss of spirit. You know, before she was just hoping it wasn't true, but now it's the irrevocability of it has finally dawned upon her, and this is where the pain is now almost fatal to her. You know, we got to make sure that it's not fatal to the goddess, otherwise we won't have anything. You know, so we got to make sure that goddess, please don't die from grief. You know, so let's all stand down and you know, help you out and comfort you here. And Trump says, no, I'm not standing down. And, you know, everybody says, oh, how dare you? How dare you, Donald? That's beyond the pale. You know, that's it.
And to get these commentators says, that's it. That was it. He's gone beyond the pale. He's finished. He's absolutely finished. It's just, from now on, it's just a matter of time before he collapses and is gone. It's essentially, he's already gone.
You've got to stand down now, you know. But Jesus is standing up for us. He's not standing down. He's standing up for us. He says the spirit can never die. So how could there be grief? How could the finality of grief hit someone that spirit is irrevocably dead? That's absolute arrogance. Total, sheer arrogance. The goddess is total sheer arrogance, and it's our own sheer arrogance projected into form, as it were. Okay. And Jesus says, no, we're not standing down. We're standing up. We're standing up. We're standing up for Jesus now. We're standing up for truth now. We're not standing down. How dare you ask me to stand down when Jesus is back? That's absolutely outrageous. See? So, that was a pivotal moment. Really, when Trump refused to stand down at that debate, they told him, in many ways, you must stand down. And he says, no, I won't stand down. And it just caused shock after shock after shock. I didn't see the whole thing, but in recapping, I understand. I saw some of it. Maybe a good portion of it. Shock after shock after shock after shock. I will not stand down. How dare you? And so finally, they brought out the goddess's assistant, you know, and says, listen, Donald, these guys, they don't, you know, you're not doing it for them, but for me, I know you're going to do it, because I really understand the goddess's grief better than they do. They're just men. They can't really understand how grief-stricken the goddess is to lose her or lover like that. But me, I'm a woman. I can really understand how much grief the goddess really has. So I'm going to ask you to stand down. You can't possibly say no to me. And Trump says, I'm not standing down for you either. Like, what? The goddess is going to kill me. She said, oh my God, the goddess is going to kill me. I was supposed to get you to stand down. I didn't do it. You know, so it was like a complete freak out cultural divide moment, actually. And the after effects of all that kind of stuff. I haven't even looked at that part of it. But it's been reported. I understand that from the after effects of it all, you know, the spin of it all, you know this, what's going on. Absolutely. You know, people just say, wow, that's it. He didn't even stand down when one of the goddess's favorites specially sent to ask it of him in a nice way. He didn't even do it then. That's, you know, completely.